Hi, my name's Ian Courts, Councillor Ian Courts, and I'm leader of Solihull Council. And in the last 3 weeks, I think every one of you will have known that we had a major conference in Glasgow of world leaders called COP26. Massively important for the planet, massively important for environment. And of course in Solihull, for several years, we've been having our own COP conference. Indeed, it's you. It's been schools and colleges. Teams have been fronting this, representing different countries. And it was organised by Solihull Council and the Interclimate Network. And frankly, it's been a highlight over the years for me. And this year, of course, I got COVID and couldn't join you. So what's always appealed to me is how great this conference is, our conference, that is, in terms of getting understanding of other people's positions, understanding of what countries have got to put up with. It's not easy for even some of the polluters in this world to take action. So to see your perspective of this was really wonderful. And my big regret is, apart from not being able to join you, is that none of the world leaders could come either. And they're more important than me, and they should have been with you. Salavi. So as I couldn't be there, I couldn't answer questions live, and I always like that. So I said, well, why don't you send your questions in, and I'll do my best to reply to them. So here we are.
How can the council help the environment by planting more trees?
Okay, now I just have a feeling that whoever has asked this question has done the homework on me, because you may know, or you should know, that trees are something I'm really passionate about. Now, the council, first of all, has a programme, Planting Our Future, it's called, 250,000 trees in this decade. Now, we're into our second year and we're well on target. The problem is, though, the council is not a big landowner, and we will be looking for more owners to find space to plant trees. Indeed, it could be individual people, it may be in your garden or whatever. It's important to have the right trees in the right place. I actually planted my first woodland 15 years ago in Lavender Hall Park. It's called Catherine's Wood. It started with little whips, and I'll tell you, it's very, very bushy at the moment. The trees are two or three times my height, and it's a haven for wildlife. And whilst we're talking about trees, it's not just trees. Hedgerows are also massively important for the environment. So that's what we're doing. My question is always going to be, how can you help us?
How do you propose on cutting down the carbon that Solihull is releasing, and how are you going to reduce the plastic and the rubbish that is surrounding Solihull and the area, and that's polluting the ocean that and is also killing the animals in the ecosystem?
We want more plastic cleanups in roads, cities and oceans, because it's dramatically affecting our environment.
Okay, a very broad question, or actually it's a set of questions, and I'll do my best to try and tackle it. There's probably two main themes coming out of that. One is about reducing the carbon emissions, and the second is other forms of pollution like waste. I think it's important to deal with them like that. In Solihull, let's deal with carbon emissions first of all. There's carbon emissions that the council emits, and then there's the borough-wide ones. Now, Solihull Council has 2030 for its target to be a net zero council. And it's doing things like it's getting zero carbon streetlights, things like that. It's reducing its plastic consumption of single-use plastics. So there's a number of things in that way, the way it collects its waste. We're looking to have more energy efficient vehicles for a start. We're having a new contractor next year, and we've baked in environmental credentials like that. So that's what Solihull Council is doing, and we're frankly always looking for new ideas sensible to take forward. As a borough, that's everybody, remembering that's much, much bigger than just Solihull Council. We've got a date of 2041 for carbon zero. And we produced a plan called Net Zero Action Plan. And that's all about how we're going to try and make this area carbon neutral. And we're very much linked with the combined authority on that, who have a similar plan for the region. So there's loads of different actions in there, loads and loads of actions. And, you know, if you're able to, just log into the website and have a look, because for me to specify one or two of those is not particularly helpful, because there are so many. But what I would say is there are two main areas that emit carbons. One is from buildings, because many of our buildings, that's houses, that's factories, leak energy. And then we have transport, and that really is about getting from A to B, and of course the car is a principal emitter on that. So that's a question. That's a question on carbon. I'm just going to move on now to plastics, which, you know, you are so right. I mean, I was able some years ago to go to the Pacific on a particular trip, and it shocked me to realise at that time 10% of our fish have plastic in them. You know, you can't find a desert island nowadays without rubbish on it. And this is a sort of pollution and waste that's happening. And it's really important that we all do something about this. And, well, you'll say, well, what can we do? I mean, start using those for a start instead of plastic bottles. Or sometimes people use plastic bottles but refill them, and that's fine. Indeed, they're probably lighter than my bottle here. So there's an example of what you can do. What else can we do? I mean, people talk a lot about recycling, how good recycling is. And it is. But, you know, it's not as good as reusing. It's not as good as reducing the amount you need. Now, you know, I love my food. I love my food. And I always eat everything on my plate. But, you know, I go into restaurants, and the number of times I see people wasting food. And, you know, have a think about it. Just take what you actually want. And remember that a lot of the food we take, it's flown in. Has anyone thought about buying local? You know, they grow food down the road. So, you know, it's one of the things that we can do, because when food comes, it also comes in packaging, and frequently that is single-use packaging, and we want to avoid that. There's some ideas for you.
How is Solihull going to adapt to the effects of climate change?
Well, interesting. I mean, there's a couple of aspects involved with this as well. I mean, one is how we mitigate the effects of climate change. And for example, I mean, there will need to be a bigger switch to electric vehicles. That's going to be essential. Not only do EVs not emit carbon into the atmosphere, they also avoid putting other noxious fumes and improve air quality. So the switch to EV is going to be important, particularly for those who live in more rural areas, which aren't so well served by public transport. There's an example. We need to do what's called retrofit on our buildings, on our houses. It's interesting, actually, if it snows sometime, you know, have a look across the roof lines, and you can spot which roofs are not insulated, because you tend to find that the snow disappears more quickly. Interesting fact, but so retrofit, improving insulation, windows and so on, is very, very important. There's a couple of examples there of how we need to mitigate. On the other hand, there's a word called resilience, and you know, the fact that is climate change is already happening, storms and stuff already happening. How do we deal with that? Well, some of the solutions are not easy. In my own ward in Dorridge, we had some terrible flooding a few months ago, and frankly, the drains just could not cope with the amount of water that came down. It was something like in an hour we had a month or two's rainfall. And, you know, how do you deal with that? Well, I mean, one of the ways is if we could avoid paving over more driveways, more front gardens than we have to, that would help. But there's no easy solutions to actually that particular issue, apart from, I know that the council's flood resilience team have mapped the area very carefully to see what work is needed and which areas are most at risk. So there's things like that that we need to adjust to. And I mean, just let's be a bit more thoughtful about the products we use. I hate to say this, but when you go to school and when you come back from school, have you ever noticed there's often quite a lot of cars around the school entrances? And have you noticed how many of them leave their engines running? Well, it's not helpful, is it? That sort of thing. So that's the sort of thing we really need to tackle.
We believe that education is the key to success, meaning our youth. You are determining our future based on your decisions, so please act fast. We believe that fast forests should be planted all around the borough and trying to fund more eco schools clubs at school.
So we are asking whether you could fund eco clubs. We will use the funding for things like planting greenery around the school and educating the youth and doing things like this conference.
I'd like to know how you'd propose to encourage in-school work and at-home recycling, plastic reduction and energy electricity reduction.
Okay, a series of very good questions there. And do you know, I'm sort of interested that you are addressing to me the questions of how much we can do. But you know what? I think you're able to do quite a lot yourselves, and you're already demonstrating that to me, frankly, by taking part in these wonderful conferences. Now, let me just give you some examples. We actually do quite a lot of work already to support schools, and I've mentioned tree planting earlier on, but just a few things that we're doing. We've got a greener schools scheme, and that's coming very shortly, actually. Our schools have been supported by business champions, really helpful to get that business connection. And, you know, frankly, the schools have taken it into their own hands to say, how can we be better on this? You know, and that really is so important, because I can keep telling you, do, do, do. My colleagues, the council can do that. But, you know, you can also say do, do, do for all of those people that you engage with. One thing where we've tried to help is on smart meters. And we've introduced a scheme with smart meters in schools. And this is interesting, because what they do is they help you to see where you are using your energy. And we've seen, since they were introduced, a big reduction in the energy usage, in those schools where they've taken these up. That's a great system. We're doing other schemes. I mean, I think I said earlier that about engines running around schools, which, you know, if we could avoid that, that would be great. Walking to school where you can also. So there are many things that can be done. And, you know, I'm really a big fan of eco clubs, but does it always cost money? I'm not sure that it does, because what we're about here is behaviour change in most cases. Behaviour change for anybody. I mean, earlier on we talked about single-use plastics, and frankly, I feel a criminal when I use a single use plastic bottle, and likewise buying local food. So there's many things that can be done, and what I think is good about in schools is getting together to help spread the word and encourage others to join in. I'm afraid there are quite a number of people, you know, in this world that really don't see there is a problem, and we've noticed this on various surveys. It's not particularly age related. Some get it, some don't. We need to make sure that everybody gets it, and I think that's a real value that you as young people can do. And frankly, you know, you are our future, and I want you to grow up thinking that, you know, I want to live in tree-lined streets. I want my parks. I want my parks to be free of litter, you know, and it's this point that I think it starts with you, and that's why I think you can do such a great job in helping us pursue this agenda.
We would like to have more solar panels and windmill powered electricity, which would help majorly.
Can we please have some legislation that might introduce eco-friendly factories?
Okay, really interesting questions. And again, they actually go to the root of what we need to do progressively to battle against climate change. I'm going to, to a certain extent, take them together. There is legislation at the moment. It's encompassed in things called building regulations that require certain standards of energy efficiency for new buildings. That's homes and commercial buildings. And I think they will progressively increase. So that is being that is happening. You find actually a lot of this is happening and you don't know about it. And I'll give you an example that you might know about, but it's a good example because it's on TV the other day. Actually, I think as a result of a podcast we were doing, because we had a company called ZF in, when we were talking about, you know, what you can do with modern buildings to make them energy efficiency. And I mean, ZF, I think they have solar panels, they have, you know, very energy efficient buildings, they have state-of-the-art manufacturing devices. But do you know what? They obviously were listening to an earlier comment I made, because they're even looked at portion control in the restaurants, and that might give me a real problem actually, because I like my food. But it's nevertheless, they're out to avoid waste. That's an example of one company who are a big company in the region and what they're doing to help. And I've been speaking to a number of businesses in Solihull over the last 18 months during the pandemic, and every single one of them is doing something to help with the environmental campaign. And it's partly because they have that genuine fear, but they all get the staff like it, their children like it, and it's, they feel they're part of doing something. So the simple answer is things are happening, to my mind, not fast enough. And I would agree, we need stronger legislation, we need stronger policy to knit climate change into our building programme. I mean, one of the things actually that Solihull is doing is we're designing and pre-planning on a town centre energy network, which, and actually we're creating very sustainable sources of energy, and we're connecting up buildings in the centre to that to make it so they don't have to have their own gas boilers, for instance. Another thing that we're doing is on the Solihull Green Homes Grant Programme, whereby homeowners can apply for measures to make the houses more energy efficient and do things like that. So there is a lot going on. We need to do more. Thank you. Okay, well, I've really appreciated the time you've put into drawing up the questions for me. You've done a great job. I suppose you've put me on the spot, and that's what you need to do. Quite frankly, when I see the enthusiasm that you have for this subject, I sometimes feel inadequate, and I think, you know, we need to do more, and we will do more. And I just want to extend my thanks to you for, you know, all the work you're putting in, and please, please keep it up. We need a better world, and you're going to help us create it.